Do I want to what? What were you gonna say?
I was gonna say, hey, do you want to plan what we might want to talk about on the show, or just kind of jump? And I think clicking record, you answered me.
Oh, I hit record. Oh, let's see if I can make this big enough for people to see.
And of course, the gentleman who clicked record is none other than Jerzy Drozd of comicsaregreat.com.
Yep.
And I am Rob Stenzinger of interactive-storyteller.com. Both of us, of course, coming to you from leanintoart.com. Lots of .coms.
Lean into art. Look at how interactive this thing is. Just look at it, look at it, look at it.
And it's cool that we're both working on sharing our desktops. I think you might want to share a different window then, Jerzy. I'm getting a filled-in view where...
You can't see what I'm doing?
Nope, not this time.
What the devil? All right, hold on. Let me make a new Illustrator.
Okay.
I was doing all sorts of typing while you were talking. I'm so bummed.
Yeah, I know. I've had that puzzle before too. It's when we're we are sharing a video version of our podcast with you. Of course, we'll be sharing audio as well, but this is going to be an extra visual episode, as we knew that we would be dealing with. Here we go. I see Jerzy's screen now.
Good. Dealing with.
I don't want to jump into the topic yet, but just to hint at it, we've got we both have Adobe Illustrator pulled up on our desktops. But
we're going to be doing some Adobe Illustrator demoing today, and this is something that we talked about. I think we've hinted at in past episodes. I don't know if we've ever come out and explicitly said this. Is that we're going to try for now to alternate between an audio-only episode where we broach some kind of tricky philosophical or theoretical topic, and then we're going to alternate that with a video episode. It'll still be an audio podcast, but it'll be relying on video to demonstrate some kind of advanced techniques, or demoing different like hands-on kind of things, or maybe some kind of presentation kind of thing. Like Rob might break out his Prezi ninja skills to do some demoing of different concepts that really rely on visual. It's a visual storytelling show, right? We're talking about being visual communicators. It just makes sense to use video for that, doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And we also, we oscillate back and forth between being hyper pragmatic and, I have principles and ethics in how I go about finishing my projects, but I definitely am willing to be very adaptive when I have deadlines looming and whatnot, right? Where it's nice to, what I'm getting at is it's fun to try to expand our brains and chew on topics and think about things from a very academic perspective. But then there's a highly practical thing that we obviously need to be focused on as well, because I would argue that to serve its purpose well, being heavily academic means you probably have less of a practical set of forces you're dealing with to enable you to focus on some interesting nuances of the topic, right?
Right.
Just because they are interesting, not because they will necessarily benefit you in any pragmatic way. But I would say oftentimes they do, especially if you switch back and forth. So that's kind of like a, you know, meta description of, like, you know, behind the scenes on how we're operating our podcast.
How we're thinking about it.
Yeah. So what
how you doing?
I'm doing pretty good, you know.
I'm getting prepped. I'm getting prepped with what some of the things I wanted to demo today, as warm up talk, no curveballs, but I had the Make the Comics Drink and Draw last night.
Mm.
I shouldn't say I had it. I did my best to facilitate a social event in Ann Arbor, the Ann Arbor drink coffee and make comics event called Make the Comics.
Gotcha, coffee. So it wasn't just sort of brush pens and beer bongs kind of thing, right?
Some people actually mentioned that. They said, like, aren't drink and draws typically held at bars? Yeah. To which I said, well, yeah, but I want kids to be able to come to this thing. And then they said, kids? And I said, yeah, why not? Why couldn't kids come to these things? It'd be an opportunity for young people who are really plugged in, who want to take an evening to draw comics, to actually get to meet some professionals in the area. I know I would have gone crazy if I had that opportunity when I was a teenager.
Oh, man, so would I. I think I don't know, maybe this is overblowing it, and I didn't mean to make your sully your event by throwing the idea that how could it exist without the beer aspect, because the all ages, it's kind of awesome. And doesn't that go back more toward like the traditional art knowledge sharing, where maybe you could have sort of, I know you're not into the guru idea, Jerzy, of course, and for the most part, I'm not, but, you know, sort of apprenticeships naturally form across different ages even, right? People who are good at different things learning from one another.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, that's the idea behind it at any rate, is that relationships will start to form. People will meet other people and they'll gravitate towards, because, like, you know, it's like, this is something Anne kind of pokes fun at me about from time to time. And I've said this on the Comics Are Great show. It's like, every Wednesday, I'll get up to do the show, and Anna like, oh, you're going to go off to do the Jerzy show, and she sings this song, the Jerzy show, and I'm like, no, it's not about me, it's about comics, and just, it's this, I feel the same way about my teaching work in Ann Arbor. It's like, I'm not the last word on this thing, and I know I'm not, and I don't want anybody to misunderstand me in thinking that either I'm trying to portray myself that way, or that I even am that. So there are things that certain kids are going to be looking for in their work that I'm not going to be able to respond to as easily as somebody else. So this is allowing that those kinds of interactions and relationships to form in a natural environment, in a safe environment, where, oh, this guy, you know, he's drawing comics more like what I want to do. Jerzy does this kind of comic, which is cool, but I want to do more stuff like what that guy's doing. Maybe he can teach me something. And you do that in a safe social environment where it's in public, where the parents are encouraged to stick around. And yeah, it's not going to get to be the kind of like no drunken mayhem. but the coffee is really good at Ruse Roast. So
that is cool.
Although, I had two big cups, and it's like really, really well-made espresso. And it is a form of intoxication to drink that much espresso. I felt really weird afterwards, like dizzy from hypercaffeinating myself. So,
did you naturally levitate, or just through your vibrations, a la the classic toy with the football characters that didn't really enact anything related to football, but they kind of went.
Yeah, it was like that metal. It's like a metal plate that looks like a football field, and it just like vibrates, and the football guys just all kind of jostle around.
Except the metal plate would be anything you're touching.
You know, what was weird was on the drive home, I felt like the car was floating. It felt really weird. I mean, and I was perfectly focused. It wasn't like, you know, I wasn't drunk, right? I'm hypercaffeinated. But I just, everything felt like it was happening very smoothly. And almost, it was a little bit like slow motion almost. Really weird.
Ooh, it was like the episode of Futurama where Fry effectively time travels because of his... what did he drink? 300 cups of coffee or something like that?
Something like that, yeah. It was, and then, like, yeah, the moment he drinks that final cup, like, time slows down and he saves everybody from the fire. It kind of felt like that. And, like, when I got home, I was like, I don't know how the heck I'm going to get to sleep. Because this was, like, 8:30 at night, and I'm drinking that much espresso. Holy cow. It's good espresso, though. But, yeah, I gotta make sure that I only have, like, one or one and a half cups. That second cup is, it'll send you over the edge, but... anyway, it was a good event, and people mentioned, I got a couple emails from people saying, like, oh, I heard about this thing, it sounds really cool, how do you get it started? It actually wasn't that hard. I felt kind of, I felt a little bit like I was getting everybody, getting away with something. Because I just went to the venue. I went to that coffee shop every Thursday anyway. And so I just said, like, hey, would you guys mind if I brought in like 20 people to do some drawing? And they're like, yeah, we got a space here. And I talked with them about logistics and about, you know, we could have enough chairs, how are we going to serve up coffee and whatever. And they were totally, they were all for it because they want the business in there. I did go to some other venues, some other types of places, a comic shop, and they said, well, we have a space, but we'd have to charge you for it. Well, I thought, gosh, I don't want to pay a rental fee on a space I'm going to only use once a month, and I'm not going to charge the people who are attending to come to this thing, so that's out of the question. I need a free space. Well, there's bars and there's coffee shops. And I thought a coffee shop would be more conducive to the kind of atmosphere that I personally want out of this thing, and plus then I also focused on a local business because I wanted to help out a local business with getting more foot traffic in there. So yeah, you just approach some places and then you just put the word out. I didn't do anything elaborate. I just created a Facebook event page and then put out a call on Twitter. And then, I guess it helps that I've spent the last couple of years generating a local network of people, but, seems like you could also put up flyers in your library or in your local comic store or I don't know.
So, I mean, it's a little bit of a chicken or egg tube where you wouldn't have to, you know, teach workshops in the area for years in order to start an event like this. You could just put an invite page out. I see a lot of people do this through Eventbrite. Am I calling that? A lot of groups of any flavor through there or whatnot. I mean, Eventbrite or a shared Google Calendar. Heck, I mean, there's nothing stopping you from doing this and casting a line out in a lot of different areas. And if you start with just one or two people, it can grow.
Yeah. I mean, we had 14 people show up, which I think is a really good start. And a couple of them drove as far as 40 minutes away to be there, which I was also really encouraged by. Just shows that there's like a demand and a need for this kind of stuff, right?
Definitely.
But I think even if you start out with just like two people, three people, that's a beginning, and then you work your way up. So, anyway.
Exactly.
I was just happy with the way it turned out. So I'm looking forward to scheduling next month's event. Anyway, so awesome. What else do you got? What else is going on, Rob?
Well, let's see. Nothing too... I cannot wait to get back to the other podcasts. I want to hear more episodes of the ones that you do, and also I'm excited to get back to doing more Polytechnicast. Not to like, you know, I don't know if that's a taboo to mention your other podcasts or whatever.
Oh, no. It's just 30 classes in 30 days, like, ate up, you know... understandably so, a significant portion of my time. I have every intention of getting back to doing Thunder Punch Daily and Fabulous Secrets.
Yeah. And well, awesome. And as I do for the Art Geek Zoo Polytechnicast, got a few different people I may be talking to lined up as well, experimenting with the whole interview and conversation format thing.
So you're going off of what I was kind of pushing you towards, the whole Dan Benjamin thing?
You hit me at the right time and place with the right kind of challenge that's intriguing. Yeah, I'm exploring it, definitely. Feeling out the space. To be honest, I see every interview as a possibility for, who knows, maybe launching another podcast. I mean, if the interest and chemistry's there or whatever, who knows? And it could happen rapidly, could happen down the road sometime. But, I would not claim I'm, you know, anywhere near as prepared as Dan Benjamin. But then again, after doing something like 30 classes in 30 days, I know we can really crank out a lot of interesting media. And there's a lot of cool people associated with what we're doing here.
Very true. There's another thing, if I could, if you don't mind me talking about something kind of crass for a second. Bust out the crass.
Like Yosemite Sam style or what?
No, you know, I, this This came up months ago when I first started doing Comics Are Great at the Ann Arbor District Library. One of the production guys came up to me afterwards, and he said, because I was getting all these different guests from all over the world to be on there, you know, like Nick Abadzis, and then, you know, like Ryan Estrada when he was in, where was he? He was in Panama, you know, getting people from New York City, but then also people from Hawaii. And this production guy comes up to me and he says, like, so is this show partially a way for you to network with other cartoonists because you're inviting them to come onto your show to talk about what they love talking about, but then you also get to know them a little bit better and you're like sort of connected to them afterwards? And I went, well, yeah, that's part of it. And he went, ah. And I went, yeah. I mean, well, that's not like a big secret or a big surprise. You know, of course I'm going to wind up networking with cartoonists. Now, where am I going with this? I personally believe that all cartoonists should be experimenting with some kind of audio blogging, video blogging, or just blogging in general. But I think the advantage to audio or video blogging is you have an opportunity to invite other cartoonists who you like or admire or are interested in to come in and talk with you about it. It's journaling, which is really a great way to like keep track of your thought process. B, it's a way to get your voice out there and put context to your work, because as we all know, in this day of rich social media and all that stuff, the artist's persona is almost as important as the work itself, or at least it's a large component into the work being enjoyed by an audience.
I have a little twist on that too. I also think it's a way for you to discover your audience and your brand, right? Because you're having these interactions with people and you discover what people value, and you will be able to possibly engage in trade with them on with the things that they're valuing, you know, and ideally doing something that you really love.
Yeah, and just have fun doing it, right? You know, and yeah, and it does force you. I mean, we've talked about this before. It's like in doing teaching, it's forced me to concretize and distill my thoughts on what I'm doing when I'm doing this stuff so that I can redistribute it to people and present it in a way that's digestible, right? So it also makes you a more thoughtful learner and so on. But in any case, I mean, another advantage to doing something like the Polytechnic Cast and bringing on other artists, it's a chance for you to get to know them in a sort of faux social environment, right? Because rather than say, like, okay, let's say, pick up a name out of a hat, Brandon Dayton. Who I know now. I mean, he's come to Kids Read Comics 2 years in a row. I've talked with him on my shows a lot. But before that, if I just enjoyed his work online and I said, like, hey, Brandon, you want to talk with me on Skype for a little while? He's like, who are you? Right? By sharing my material, by sharing my thoughts, and by doing things like the Microcast, like Thunder Punch Daily, like the Leading Into Art Cast, like Comics Are Great, he got to know me by hearing my voice that way. And then when I did approach him, like, hey, you should be on my show. And then we could have our first conversation in a controlled environment where none of us feel like we have to have any obligation to one another. And then if we get along, then we can keep pushing that forward. We can keep pursuing. Like, I don't talk to every Comics Are Great guest all the time. It's like we don't all call each other on the phone or anything. But when we hit it off, when we have a good exchange of ideas and we seem to really riff off of each other well, then, you know, we can stay in touch. And so you can also expand your network that way, right?
Exactly. And and that's for it is not just crass. I mean, it's sort of a lifestyle thing, and hopefully, you know, there's some, you have a pleasant, I don't know, whatever works for you experience in that lifestyle. Like for me, I like having somewhat of an integrated go at things with an overlap of some people that I consider professional collaborators, our friends, and some, you know, but, and it doesn't always have to be that way. It's nice to explore that so you can have some nice overlapping, you know, because sometimes this is a good venue to, you know, for me to socialize with you, Jerzy, right? The exactly. Leaning Toward.
Yep.
There's an example of that.
No, I've said this a bunch of times, even on the Comics Are Great show, that it's my social hour. It's a way for me to get to talk with cartoonists. Right, so.
Yeah. And of course that practice of when you're in a position where you have to somehow transmit what you're doing, what you're experimenting with, and what you know. If you were operating totally out of your gut, then you have to find a way to at least present it in a way where someone else could operate out of their gut and get somewhere similar, right? And that's that kind of act. I mean, I agree. It's been very helpful. And I was inspired by the Art and Story Supreme Service. Obviously, the podcast itself, but then, you know, joining the Art and Story Supreme Service and all those microcasts. You know, it's not surprising that not too long after that, that's when I started the Art Gigzoo Polytechnicast.
Ah.
Because I saw, I'm like, hey, look at these guys. What the heck? I can do that. No, I thought.
That's exactly it, actually.
No, it's a little bit of that. But no, mostly it was, I can hear how they're getting sharper at their craft by presenting in this way. And I'm like, well, no time like the present. Let's, time to get moving on it.
The real trick, I mean, just to like hopefully wrap up this idea about like doing podcasts, but the thing about doing like Thunder Punch Daily, a microcast where it's just me, which at first was terrifying, and then it became invigorating because it's like, this is mine. I'm not sharing this with anybody. I get to like do whatever I want with this. That kind of sense of ownership is really, really cool. But then also, for me, it became really important to have a point every time and not just be like a journal of my life, like, oh, this is what I did today. But like, okay, what was the takeaway today, if there is one? If not, then do an essay on something else. That part gets tricky. That part was actually kind of tough, and it continues to be tough with the show, but it's also challenging and fun, and it helps me stay sharp and stay on my feet and everything. So, but that's not to say that a simple journal cast of here's what I worked on today and here's kind of what I thought about while I did, not to say that wouldn't be interesting either.
Absolutely. Honestly, the Art and Story Supreme Service was an example of people taking multiple approaches on that same premise of, well, you know, provide a regular art podcast related to the things you cared about and were working on. And I would say Mark Rudolph of markrudolph.com and Kevin Cross of kevincross.net. and laserbeamsgo.com. They would take different approaches too, and it was really fun to see that. That's where I was like, okay, well, it's a viable, interesting thing with a bunch of different approaches. So I know that I could stumble around and figure out what's going to work for me. And
that's awesome. That is so awesome that we were able to achieve that just by splitting up. And you know, the whole microcast idea came out of expediency. It's like, how can we create $10 worth of content every month? Well, none of us, between the three of us, we don't have the time to do X amount of extra shows. We can't all meet to do X amount of extra shows. Well, what if we split up? What if we split up and I'll do one, you do one, and you do one? Then we got three extra things a week that we're giving people, right? So cool that inadvertently, by doing that, we presented a proof of concept that here's three unique ways to look at spending 15 minutes in front of a microphone.
It just was because part of it is just saying, well, what you do is going to be naturally aligned. You have a voice of whatever's driving your creative acts, right? Yeah. And it's going to come out. You know, people who are more about the live, seat of your pants, wing it, whatnot stuff. Yeah, I mean they've got their way of presenting and obviously you can be a combination because I would say like the Polytechnicast is definitely a mix of trying to do I definitely try to share something useful, but I'm cool if that comes out in a journal form or in an essay, that kind
Funny.
Of thing.
Because like I usually like to wing a lot of stuff. But when it comes to Thunder Punch Daily, that's like the one area where I'll actually sit down and take notes on what I'm actually going to discuss. Sometimes I'll actually outline it too. Like if ever you hear me in a Thunder Punch Daily going point one, point two, point three, that's because I've got an outline sitting in front of me while I'm talking.
Yeah.
Anyway. But I think more people should be messing around with that. I think, and it's not just about like a paying it forward or it's a rite of passage. Everybody has to go through this thing to be a better presenter. I also just think it has a lot of benefits for the cartoonist, personal benefits that won't be as apparent to the public. But and I also think that, you know, anybody who's going to say like, oh, well, there's a million comics podcasts, so what? Are you doing this to be famous, or are you doing this because you want a personal benefit out of it?
Oh, dude, you're hitting a button. That's the whole myth of originality problem, yeah. Right? Well, someone else did it. I can't do it. If that were true, we'd be done by now, all of us.
Yeah.
Because guess what? There's many, many, many billions of people over history that have had the human experience and have expressed things regarding it, and, well, it's done by now. Except it's not been done in your voice.
I'm going to dog ear that one for follow-up, Rob, because I had a conversation with somebody about this recently where they were actually made a pretty interesting argument for what you're arguing against, where they said, yes, but never in human history was there a period where everybody was expressing it. And so much of what people expressed was lost to time. And now everything's being recorded and jotted down. Is that not a argument for you should shut up unless you got something unique to say? I know what your answer is going to be. I know what my answer is going to be, but we'll save that for a future philosophical sure. episode.
Sounds good.
But yeah, I mean, it's like they always do, everybody does the, oh, well, that's all well and good for you because you're Rob Stenzinger and you're one of the gifted ones. You're one of the special ones. I'm not special, but yeah. Okay. Well, do we want to do some Illustrator stuff? Want to play around, have some fun?
Yep. That sounds very good. Why don't you kick it off? Like, what was one of the things? I see your dialogue balloon there, and actually that reminds me, you have a workshop coming up that's related to this.
The heck you say? Yeah, no, this isn't an ad, everybody. You know, it's our show. We get to do in-show ads if we want to.
Sure.
This is leanintoart.com. It's a learning network, and we, in addition to the podcast, we also do like premium content in the form of hands-on workshops. And yeah, January 7th, 11th, and 14th, I'm going to be leading three sessions, actually two sessions with a lab for FATAM, creating sound elements in Adobe Illustrator. And it's going to be a more robust and in-depth look at my thoughts on sound design and how I pull them off. Sort of inspired by the class I did for 30 classes in 30 days, which was lettering in Adobe Illustrator. I discovered very quickly that an hour is not enough time to go into all the things I think about in terms of designing sound elements and also potentially logo elements in Illustrator. I've learned a lot of tricks over the years that I'm always happy to share, and sound design is one of my favorite subjects in the whole world. I think it's one of the most fascinating aspects of comics, and I think it's an overlooked aspect of comics. I think it's a real shame when cartoonists intentionally avoid the world of sound in their work, because comics is expressing all of the senses with just lines and colors, which is, as I've said before, kind of like magic. So registration is on the Lean Into Art website. We'll link to it in the show notes for this episode. And as a lead-in to doing that workshop, I thought it might be fun for us to just tool around a little bit in Adobe Illustrator to see what are some of the things that we'd be exploring in that class. Also, to create some useful content out of, this isn't to say like, oh, we're going to show you a couple teases that makes you have to take the class. No, this is really useful stuff for anybody who wants to mess around in Illustrator. But if you want a really in-depth approach, then I would encourage you to try out the class. But so what do you want to see first, Rob? Or do you want to show me something?
Well, we should develop a randomizer here. what the heck? I'm happy to... I was playing around with something while we were talking in the earlier part of the podcast.
I can't see what you do. Oh, you've been drawing.
It's kind of funny. I actually happen to be logged into Adobe Connect in a way that I can see what Jerzy's doing, but he actually can't see what I'm doing. I've actually moved toward a second stage of something that you could argue, based on the frequency with which I've posted on this versus how many other things I've not posted about or whatever, like there's this silhouette technique that Krishna Sadasivam of PCWeenies.com, who also taught a four-session course during 30 classes in 30 days called Creating Crazy Characters, he used this darn silhouette technique a bunch of times. And I'm now infected. And I've been playing with it a bit. And well, I actually I recorded a video and posted it on interactive-storyteller.com about using this silhouette technique, but actually mostly on an iPad application called InkPad. Mm. And in this case, it's well, the sort of kingpin of vector art tools is I suppose you switched from sharing modes. That's cool. The kingpin of vector art tools is, well, Adobe Illustrator. It's pretty much a de facto standard throughout the industry, I would say. And so what I was doing when I was creating this character is just using Krishna's silhouette technique, which my summation of it is basically let's see, you create shapes by so you create these shapes. I'll explain how I create them in a second, and to just give a nutshell of this, you think about the character's posture and their sort of inner life and outer life and what are they wearing and all that, and then you create a silhouette of it, and the idea is so they're very readable and you have an idea about what the character's about and whatnot. And anyway, for more details, I would recommend taking Krishna's class or whatnot. But anyway, to do this kind of shape, you can you basically select the brush tool and make sure you have a fill in there. And then also on the brush tool properties, make sure you have a fill new brush strokes checkbox checked. And then anytime you make a line, bam, it automatically fills. So that's one of the more addictive aspects of this, is that it's so fun to play with it, where all of a sudden you're making these fully realized silhouettes by just, quick brush movements. And so if I draw a character next to this guy, whoops, that is, more of a sagging, sort of a sagging posture, and whoops. You can see that basically I'm doing it by, just quickly running the brush tool along, making a shape, and then picking up, and all of a sudden, bam, there's a filled shape, and then I continue.
It's quick. It forces you to be quick, and I'm wondering if it also forces you to not be too precious about it, because if you accidentally pick up the pen, it's going to automatically fill the shape when you don't expect it, which means you're going to get a little bit of those happy accidents that are tougher to come by in digital illustration.
Oh, very true. And I think it has they have a funny feel to them, at least so far when I've been studying, is that they're a little bit organic feeling and a little bit, maybe that's why is sort of the urgency of, I picked my pen up and I'm going to finish the shape. But it's also fun to just keep building along and adding more shapes. And then if you're like, well, wait a minute, what about, I want to add a little more detail to this, then just, set some other color to the, your canvas background or whatever. Then you can sort of cut into it effectively. And anyway, that's a fun way to use Illustrator. And this is mighty, mighty similar to how I do character coloring in Illustrator too. Hmm. Which is part of, I think that was another thing where I got all excited.
Look at all those layers.
Yep.
What is with all those layers, Rob?
I have a standard template for my comic episodes that I use for Illustrator, because Illustrator is one of the anchor tools in my toolbox to finish a comic page.
Okay.
And yeah, so I'm always going to be doing my lettering here. Possibly other steps as well.
Okay.
And this template is left over from when it's a refined version of it, but I did about 30 episodes or so of Art Geek Zoo fully in Illustrator. So.
Wow.
It's a very viable tool.
No, it is. It's just, it's one of those tools that mystifies a lot of cartoonists. and that's one of the reasons that I wanted to do a class on it too, was, you know, a lot of people are like, well, why not just letter in Photoshop? Well, because Illustrator has a few affordances that Photoshop doesn't have. And that's why it still exists as a program. So, okay.
And there you go. I mean, so this is essentially a set of, this is a more simplified toning approach that I'll do for, it's like a rapid version of coloring instead of having to, you know, put in full colored with this, you know, I have a standard color palette for my characters and all that. And then, and this is similar to how I would shadow things. And I know from a color theory standpoint, this is sort of an incorrect way to do it. But it muddies colors. They don't look as rich, right? So if I had, let me turn on the line art, and I'll make Crunchy green. I guess if Crunchy has shadow on him, he doesn't have shadow on him in this case. If you are simply dimming colors by not adding their complementary color, it doesn't look like natural light behaves.
Yeah, yeah.
And so this approach is a cheat, and it doesn't come off as vibrant.
One of the things that we talked about on the last episode of Comics Are Great, as a matter of fact, episode 41 with Brandon Dayton of BrandonDayton.com, a Lean Into Art instructor, he talked about how whatever your highlight color is, like if you've got a yellow light pouring on you, the shadow is going to be, at least part of it, is going to be the complement to that yellow. So there'll be purple in the shadow. If the light is red, there'll be a little bit of green in the shadow. So I see what you're saying. You want to work with complements. So knowing your color wheel is actually kind of useful.
Yeah, it is. I mean, and even though there's a difference between knowing it and feeling like it's an accessible tool. And maybe some people feel that way about Illustrator in general. It's like, I can get by. I can make my business cards. But my whole comics page? You're crazy, you know?
Yeah.
But, you know, once you get more familiar with it, we'll see. I'm going to try to hold myself to using better color theory. But my cheat was I would do this, my shadows and highlights in essentially percentages of the pure white or black on the whole layer. And, you know, so if we look at like my dark shadow layer and its opacity is 61%. Mm-hmm. So my medium is 34.
Gotcha.
And so, yeah, I mean, it's sort of like a standard toning approach. But then I would do that with whites, I would do that with blacks, and then I would have my flat colors in there. And that's how Art Geek Zoo was colored till this point.
So you'd fill everything with just black, and then you would change the opacity on each layer for each shadow or shading field. Gotcha.
Yeah, the trade-off being if I'm adding these shapes together and the shapes themselves possess the transparency information, I will end up, so if I change my brush opacity and I start playing with that, all of a sudden you'll notice I have sections that are, I can visibly see are overlapping.
Yep, and maybe they're starting to add to each other's opacity. So if you put a 20% opaque circle over top of it, intersecting with another 20% opaque circle, you get that Venn diagram look where they're intersecting, it's now 30 or 40% gray.
Yep.
Or black, I should say.
So to avoid that, I would do the one pure color on the whole layer. And or you could mix colors, but they would be at 100% opacity on the brush, but then adjust the layer so that you can have the even. So if I, once you, it's too late. I guess you could select the brush strokes and then readjust their opacity if you changed your mind or whatever. But
and see, an alternate way to do that would be to create a custom palette. And this is what I did when I was half toning the front. And the replacements, for that matter, is I had a custom palette for each comic of like, okay, Thirsty's pants are this percent black. His, his shadows are this percent black. Rex's shadows are this percent black. And I just had it up on a palette on my screen, and I would just drop in that fill color all on one layer. So, you know, trace the shape, fill it with that percentage of black, and then I don't have to mess with opacity or anything like that. So if I were, but then again, one of the advantages of Adobe Illustrator is it doesn't eat up that much of your resources to run a bunch of layers in Illustrator because it's all vector. And, you know, just a simple tap on that layer on the layers palette will select everything that's on that layer. And I don't know if what you'd call this kind of interface, but like unlike Photoshop where you're painting pixels onto a layer, in Illustrator you're placing objects on a layer and you can just click on the object rather than, let's say I'm in Photoshop and I put a blob of gray on layer 6 and I'm working in layer 12 and I want to move that blob on layer 6. Well, I got to go to the layers palette, select layer 6, then grab my arrow tool and now I can move the thing. In Illustrator, as long as I can click on it, no matter what layer I'm on, it'll just automatically take me to that layer, and then I can move the thing. So it's sort of like giving you access to every item on the stage using Flash lingo, but simultaneously letting you work within the context of layers. That's one thing I love about Illustrator. I don't know if I explained it very well.
Well, it's the behavior of... Well, it's a different mindset, and you get used to it. You can even just play with Illustrator and get... a feel for it, but what's happening is you're dealing always with lines and shapes. Everything is a line or a shape, or you may have a shape that has a border on it, right? So it's everything, like this is one complete line, what I just made right here, right? And the circle I put around it is a separate complete line, but then if I did it as one, you know, this is, even though it's a bigger shape, it's one complete line.
Yep.
Because it is basically keeping track of things every time I pick up the brush. It's like, oh, okay, new piece of math to store. Boom, another piece of math. Boom. And it, yep. So for every piece or object or what have you, it's a separate thing that you can always come back and select, where in Photoshop, it's all one sea of pixels per layer. Mm-hmm. And yeah, you can mix and match some vector things and selections and stuff. But for the most part, you're dealing with a stack of grids of pixels.
That's a nice way to put it. Thank you. That was a much better abstraction of what I was trying to say.
I added to it. Whatever.
Okay, so is it my turn to share something?
Oh, please. Yes.
All right. Let's
boot me out of here.
Boot yourself out. I only shut off my screen sharing just because I noticed that the video on us, we were running at about like 5 frames per second. Our audio was still good, but it's like we started going.
Oh,
we're talking. Yeah. Yeah, like jerking around. I think it was just like saying, Adobe Connect was saying like, hey, you're asking me to do an awful lot. Here's a trick to creating three-dimensional sound effects. Get rid of that. Let's move this over. So I type a, you seeing this okay, Rob?
I'm totally seeing it. It looks great.
Okay. So I just typed the letter T, and I'm using Impact as a font because this is a good base font for doing a lot of sound effects. I modify it heavily, though. I don't just go something that always bums me out when I see that. And this is one of the reasons I want to teach sound design classes. Like when somebody just goes, and that's their sound effect, you know?
It's yeah.
Like, they're like, oh, well, here you go. I'll throw you a bone jersey. Oops. And I'll do this. And look, now it's a sound effect. It's red. And I go, well, yeah, but it still looks like you just kind of typed on a screen. It doesn't look like you did any design work here. This is an opportunity to design. So I'm going to take my letter T, and I'm going to go to type, create outlines, or Command-Shift-O to turn it into outlines. Most of us who have used Illustrator know this. And then I'm going to grab the, what is this arrow tool called? Come on, hover over it for a second. Direct selection tool. And I'm just going to like drag over just a couple of the points that I want to modify. Because like your black arrow tool selects the entire object. The white arrow tool, you can use to select just different Bezier points in the shape. So I'll modify my T to make it a little imperfect, little off balance. You can shift click to modify just a couple points at a time. And now I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to make sure I got a lot of layers. I'm going to bring this to the topmost layer, and I'm going to make this a different color. Let's make this some kind of red, okay? And then I'm going to option click on it to copy it, and I'm going to drop it little bit offset like this. This is going to be pretty procedural, Rob, just to warn you. And I'm going to drag that to two layers behind it, okay? And then with my black arrow tool, I'm going to option shift click on a corner so I can change its size. And that's so I can like reduce its size from the center point. Maybe move it up a little bit higher. And I'm going to change its color to a darker red. So now it's kind of like a drop shadow, right? Well, this is where we get into something neat. Now, I intentionally left layer 3 between these two layers empty. Now I'm going to go to, I don't know if you've ever done this, Rob. You ever changed the view to outline?
By accident, yes.
This is super useful. I'm going to grab my pen tool now, and making sure that I got layer 3 selected, I'm going to click on the corner point of this layer, of this T, and connect it to there. Go to this point, and this point, and then finish the shape. Because like when you're using the pen tool, when you hover over the last point to where it says now it's going to close the shape, the icon will change to, and I have my caps lock on, so it'll change to, you probably can't see my cursor very well on the screen, but your icon will change to, it'll have a little circle next to it saying like the next click will complete the shape. And I've completed that shape, click off of it, and I'm going to do it again. And I always start on the hovering over the bottommost layer. There's a reason for that I'll go into in a second. And I'm going to click at the points. And the neat thing about Illustrator in its base setting or its standard preferences setting, it will lock, it will snap to points. So it's snapping to the point that is immediately under it. So I don't have to be terribly precise about where I'm placing these points. And I'm drawing another shape. Okay, now why did I do this? I'm going to go back to view, preview view, and I'm going to select these shapes, and I'm going to make these different colors. Make this more of an orange. Brighter orange. Make this, I'll leave that dark, and I'll make this that brighter orange using my eyedropper tool. And now I've created a sort of a three-dimensional effect where you can actually alter all of the different highlights and shadows on it. You can even use gradients on this if you want to. So I can take this and go to my gradient tool and make this orange the source color, make the second color of the gradient a yellow. So, and then I can take my gradient tool and create some pretty interesting highlight and shadow effects on this.
That is way cool. I've been wondering how the heck you do that. Like, I see people do that extruded text effect.
Yeah.
And I'm like, there's got to be a good pattern for that, but you know, never quite. Because I've been in a situation where I'm like, I wanted to use that effect. And
there's another way to do it. There's another way to do it, but I don't like this one as much because it doesn't. It has that extruded look, but it's not as easy to modify. It's easier to do, but it's not as easy to modify after the fact. Whereas this version that I've done here, I can, you know, export it and make it as big or small as I want. This one becomes a little bit more memory consumptive. So have you used this tool? Let me see where it is. Oh, it's right here. It's the blend tool.
Oh, okay.
So not for double tap.
The Macromedia freehand, but
okay. Yep, this was in freehand. Ooh, you're going back a pace, going back to freehand.
I know.
I once worked at an agency where that was the design tool of choice. They designed all their ads in freehand.
I love freehand.
And the guys who were using it, I was like, "Well, you're using freehand." And they're like, "Yeah, it's a lot better than Cork Express." I was like, "Are you kidding me?" And they're like, "Yeah." They had some pretty strong opinions on it, but. Anyway, this blend tool. So I'm gonna double click on. Well, here, get out of it again, so I can walk through this step by step. I'm gonna double click on the blend tool. This option comes up, and you have an opportunity to change the spacing. And I'm gonna change it to specified steps. And I'm gonna say like I don't know 100 specified steps. Okay. Now the blend tool, the cursor display on Adobe Connect, it always defaults to like an arrow. But what I'm looking at on my screen is it's like a little box with dots that imply a gradient fade away from it. And I'm going to hover over one corner of the T with that, click once, and then I'm going to hover over this the matching corner of the T, and then the icon changes to have a little plus sign, meaning like, okay, you're going to complete this blend. And I tap again, and then it creates a blend effect. But now it's going to treat this thing like it's one object. It sort of it automatically groups it, and all those specified steps are not shapes. It's sort of like creating like a faux gradient from the shape behind it to the shape in front of it. So what I'll often do is I'll take this T in my layers palette, make a new layer, and copy this one to the layer above, hide this layer, then I'll go ahead and do the blend effect. Where grab that corner, and we got the blend, and now I got the T above, so I can change this to some other, like a darker red or something, or a brighter red for that matter, or put a stroke on it, right? So it pops out a little bit more.
But you have a lot less control over that other option then.
I mean, I use both. If you look at like the Sugary Cereals logo or the logo on the front, the current version of the front trade paperback. I mean, what this is December 2011. The version that is currently in print uses the effect on the right. The effect on the left is the one I used for the new front logo, which I've been putting on some of the different designs that I've been posting on my website. But yeah, this one you have a higher degree of control over what kind of color keying is going on. So like I could do something where, you know, I use playing on this idea of that you were talking about earlier about playing with complementary colors, right? Or I could do stuff where you have a lot of contrast if that's what you're going for, right?
Yeah, that's very clever.
You know, you could use like a lot of cool colors on one side and warm colors on the other side. Now, look, granted, what I'm doing right here, this is really garish, but you get the idea. It's for demonstration purposes. And it does get complicated when you start using round shapes. So like if I, you know, convert this to outlines, do the same deal, move it behind, reduce its size, put on a layer behind. Let's put this layer above. So now if I'm going to connect these, so if I go to view outline, and I go to view outline because it allows me just to see the paths, right? I'm not getting confused by any colors or anything. It's a nice diametric way of, or I mean, diagrammatic way of looking at it. But now I'll go to a layer behind, and what I would be doing then is I'd be using the pen tool, just like I did before, tap, 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 and tap, complete this shape. But now what I'd be doing is to do this curve, I'd be estimating where I'm going to place that point, and then I'm going to try to match the curvature. And here, I don't always get it right. I'll do my best to approximate it. See what I'm doing?
Yeah, I do see what you're doing. That's wild. Definitely, you know, a bit harder than matching straight, flat lines.
Yeah, and I'd go in afterwards and modify these curves. So, like, how I'm doing this is I'm clicking once with the pen tool, and then I'm holding down the click, and then I'm dragging. And by dragging, that creates that curve with those anchor handles. And so I'll go ahead and complete the shape, and then I'll grab my white arrow tool, and I'll grab these points, and I'll move them, or, I'll move the handles to try to match that shape as close as possible. And when you're in outline view, it becomes a lot easier to match that shape because you're just got to get like right on that path, right?
That is super. That's like, now I think I will use outline view on purpose sometimes.
Yeah, I use it whenever I do this effect. And the other, you know, this is where like the, you know, you always wonder why does Illustrator apply color labels to each layer? Well, that comes handy when you're managing a lot of layers, but it becomes especially handy in outline view, right? Because now it's like, which line is which? Well, if I hover over this line, it shows me that, oh, I'm dealing with what's on layer 5 because that's the layer marked yellow. Oh, I hover over this one, it changes the line to blue. Now I'm dealing with what's on layer 4 because that's the one that was marked blue, right?
Yeah, very handy.
And so I'm getting it pretty darn close to that G color. And so if I go back to preview view, I can take this and I can give this a gradient. And look at that. It's giving the impression that this is an extruded curved object. Right? Pretty neat, huh?
Wow. Yeah.
I love this effect. And look at this is just like a straight up linear gradient. I didn't do anything fancy with this, right? Just like yellow to green. and it gives it that really cool lighting effect on it. So,
yeah, it makes the shape interesting in a in a way that, I mean, you can play with perspective quite a bit here, where you don't, it's not like you just I don't know, there's a lot of tools that I've come across where you could just type out some text and then have it sort of 3D extruded, literally in a 3D, you know, manner, mm-hmm. with 3D rendering, and then it'll output a you know, either a vector or a typically a bitmap file, but that's, you know, that's more hard and fast rules, or that are not as easy to modify. You have to really mess with a camera and camera angle and stuff. Where this, I mean, you just have a lot more control.
Yeah, and I suppose you could do this like in something like Google SketchUp pretty easily. But then, yeah, I haven't done that and exported it to see like what kind of degree of control you have over like the color effects afterwards, right? So like, I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna show you one more thing. Okay, so let's say like I'm happy with this. Like, oh, this looks really good.
It might be cool actually to go ahead and blow your screen up to the full size.
Oh gosh, yeah. Here, that might be a good idea. So let me do that real quick.
And cool.
Is that better?
Yep.
So let's say what? Go ahead.
It will be right now. It is. It's doing the blocky thing where it's stopping me from seeing.
Oh, correctly. Really? Still doing it? Hold on. Let me do this.
Could be a delay.
And I'll do this. How about now? And
nope,
I'll try
still.
It one more time. What I'm trying to do is I might have to like stop sharing and then reshare.
Sure. That's probably a good idea.
So stop sharing, and then I'll share my screen, and then share Illustrator, please. Thank you. How about that?
And it's coming. There it is. Yay.
All right.
Perfect.
Cool. All right. So let's say I like the way this T looks. It's looking pretty darn good. But man, it could use a stroke around it. Well, that's going to be problematic because we're dealing with a whole bunch of different shapes. And if we give each of these shapes a stroke, it's going to look pretty goofy. I want a stroke around the entire thing. So I'm going to grab it. I'm going to copy it just by option click and dragging. And then I'm going to change all of the fills to one fill color. So I'm going to go to my color palette. Change its fill color to, doesn't matter, that brown will do just fine. And then I'm going to go to my Pathfinder, and I'm going to go to Unite. Oh, why did it not do that? Oh, because I didn't have anything selected. I want to do that. I'm going to Unite this object, and if you had any imprecise paths in there, like if like they weren't perfectly overlapping, you might have a couple stray paths to just delete. Go do that with your pen tool. And minus, you hover over with your pen tool any points, and it'll to change the pen icon to have a minus sign next to it. That means if you tap again, you're going to delete this point, right? So just get rid of any straight points for what I'm about to do next. Yeah, see, there's a whole shape in here that I got to get rid of. Oh, for corn's sake, go away. I don't want you. Okay. So now I'm going to go and grab this shape, and I'm going to go to Object, Path, Offset Path. I'm going to offset it by, let's say, 8 points or 8 pixels. Seems like a good number for the size I'm working. Drag that shape below, delete the shape above, and now I have, oh, I got to drag it all the way to the back. I have a really cool, I'll just change this to black so it actually has some contrast. And I have a cool outline for my extruded T. Now it looks
nice.
Extra bold. And there's some stray points on here that I can just get rid of just by grabbing the pen tool. Usually these kinds of, whenever I do any kind of grouping like this, I have to do a little bit of cleanup. And grab this point with the white arrow. And voila. And that's how you create a really cool extruded text effect with a nice border. And you can keep on, you know, expanding out the border by going to Object, Path, Offset, Path. Let's do a little bit smaller this time. Let's go 6 pixels and then drag that to a layer behind. Or in this case, I'm going to make a new layer, drag that onto that layer, and then drag this layer to the bottom. And then I'm going to give this one, you know, a gradient. You can just keep on building out that way and create some pretty cool effects. So,
yeah, that's very slick. I like it.
I don't know how long we've been going. I don't know if there's any time to do any other things.
I did, let's see. I think we've been going close to an hour.
Okay.
So, you know, we could wrap up. I do have something else I could share too.
Okay.
But
I'll let, since I'm doing the class, I'll let you do the bulk of the sharing this time. Maximize your window here. What else you got?
Well, let's see. There's a couple things. I wanted to do like a really quick, here's how I do word balloons for my comics in Illustrator.
You do it differently than I do.
Yeah, which, I mean, oftentimes just means I, poked at the interface until it, shot out a candy pellet, and I was like, ooh, I'm going to repeat this. And then that kind of thing. And there's some accidents where I found, so a normal text area, if you type something in there, whoops, what's going on there? All right. And then, you know, put a space, and you have more words. I'm kind of operating a little bit weird here with I'm right-handed, whatever. So anyway, I'm just kind of making up some text here. So if I need to resize this, this is how a normal text box behaves in Illustrator.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know when I see a lot of people doing tutorials on laying out text, I see them trapped by this, and then they'll try to sort of add their own carriage returns and whatever based on how they want their word balloon to flow, to try to have the text given have a nice shape from, you know, where more or less, let's see if this is right. So let's say you have a word balloon and you want your text to be narrow, wider, narrow, flowing in there with some kind of, you know, good consistent space along, you know, along the outside. So I've learned, and obviously you can look at old episodes of Art Geek Zoo and see where I've, when I finally figured that out. Because it wasn't in the beginning. but, you know what? I stumbled onto something. Instead of using the default text tool...
Oh, if you start, I know what you're going to do. I know what you're going to do. This is cool.
And what's funny is then I never had to do this again. Because once you do this, and if you save a template or whatever, you don't have to worry about it. Let's see. Did I add that correctly?
Yep.
So we're having spaces in the text and whatever. And hey, wait a minute, it's getting, you know, carriage returns automatically. So I hit Command Enter to stop editing, and now my text is reflowing instead of, you know, growing and shrinking. And it's like, well, what font size is that? What font size is this other one? Well, here it's the same thing as I set in the beginning, and my text just reflows. So that's one trick. So essentially, it's make a shape. Doesn't matter because you're going to be able to resize it, but then use the area type tool instead of just the regular type tool. Mm-hmm. Click on that shape, fill it with text, and then for me it's faster to then for the rest of them to just control click to clone that, or I guess it's a option click to clone it. Anyway, and then I paste my new text. But I actually don't even do that. you can do that, and that's still a time saver, and it's handy because you're going to be able to adjust your word balloons. And that's a big thing. It's like, I don't care how tightly you've laid out, what if you come up with something better? And I'm ridiculously iterative. So I'm like going to change the text until it's published. And then I might go change it like one more time. All right, so this is an example of how I have a placeholder font, the right text, and whatever that I want. And then I'm going to go to my text editor to grab the text for this episode, go back over to Illustrator, paste it in here. So this is all the text, only separated by carriage returns, right? So I hit paste, Command-Enter, so it's done editing that, right? make sure it's selected, and then I do an action that it's scripts, and I put it in my favorites, divide text frame, wha-bam. And now I have separate word balloon text to quickly throw around in, you know, where I need to. So I just do. I don't remember this, to be continued.
This divide text frame script something that you made custom? Because I'm looking in my menu right now.
No, it's a download. We'll have to link to it. Okay. But I highly recommend this download. Anyway. So here I am just kind of laying it out basically. I need to, you know, make some of these taller and some more narrow. A lot of times I would lock these other layers so I don't accidentally select them. So here you go. Like, you see the text is getting laid out. And, you know, I started with one. My default template is pretty close to a standard word balloon width that I end up using. But you know what? Often it needs to get adjusted, and this is way easier to adjust it by just grabbing the boundaries than it is by somehow predicting how wide it needs to be and then dealing with the frozen shape.
Yeah.
Anyway. So that's how I lay out the text. Then I'm going to lock that layer and then go to my word balloons. And then here is the other aspect. Did you have any comments or questions on that, Jerzy?
No, this just looks like it replicates more of a word processor kind of, or desktop publishing application kind of way of thinking about text. Like, you think about like InDesign, Quark Express, PageMaker. Anybody use PageMaker anymore? Usually you deal with text in text boxes, not just like, and one of the things that's weird about Illustrator is text just happens on a line. And then when you try it, like you showed, like when you try to modify the width of that text field, it modifies the width of the text itself. This gives you a completely different way of going back towards more of a desktop publishing kind of application approach, which is actually pretty handy in terms of centering text.
Yeah. Because I mean, if you're managing a story, you may be managing a lot of text. It helps me do, so I do all my spell checking and all that kind of stuff ahead of time, so it's less likely to have errors and whatnot. Learning all that by pain of experience. Mm-hmm. Then I switch to the brush tool again, and I do a similar technique like I was doing with the filling in the colors. So this is the settings on that balloon, on the brush tool, where I went back and I checked fill new brush strokes, and you know, I set my my fill color to be white and my border color to be black, and I changed the stroke width. So then I just go around doing natural ovals, and that takes a little practice, but what it does, so like, it's like, if this little thing, because it's a filled, I'm covering that background already, right? Mm-hmm. So here we go. And then obviously I have, you know, puzzles where a lot of times I try not to have the character saying the same two different word balloons and whatever without having them chain, because that would create a more of a flow of the dialogue. So I could end up having this word, whatever that's called, a mutant tail that connects the two. So then
it's a trunk.
It's a trunk. Okay.
That's what I've called it. I think I've heard other people call it that. The tails and trunks.
Tails and trunks. Okay, cool. So then what I'd have to do is then switch my border color to be white. Then I go in and get rid of that. And if my lines are going too deep into the balloon, I might fix it.
Mm-hmm.
With that approach. And that's it. I mean, then just go through it all, and it's on its separate layer, and there you go.
Wow. I mean, that seems like a much more intuitive approach to doing it than the way I do it. as you've seen the way I do it, where I actually will make a standard ellipse and then I'll go and modify the Bezier points to make it look like it was hand-drawn, whereas you're hand-drawing it. So very cool.
Yeah, but the thing is, yours is, I mean, this isn't like a way to put a competing idea out there for it. It's just yours is super precise looking. Like, it looks professional. Like, this, it looks like a Marvel or DC balloon to me. You know what I mean? Like, it's so clean. And, you know, it has character to it because you adjust the shapes. But then, and of course, we're talking about what it's like watching Jerzy do this in his class, which I got to do during 30 classes in 30 days. And, of course, you'll be covering it in even more detail in the upcoming workshop. But, I mean, this approach, and it was playing around. Like, I've look back at old, not that you have to go surf my comic archives, whatever, you know, buy all my playsets and toys, of which there's very few and whatever. Anyway.
But do sign up for the class. Do.
Exactly. Sign up for Jerzy's class. There's no disclaimers going on there. Nothing but awesome knowledge to be gained. Right. Anyway.
I wasn't trying to compete there. I just think it's neat that there's, as usual with Adobe products, there's like a zillion ways to do anything, you know?
There is. What I discovered is I wanted to try to play with this word balloon style that, like you said, as far as the design, when you want to have more control over the result, you can adopt new techniques that give you that character that you're looking for in your final design, because every single element could be influenced by your design if you choose to. You don't have to just take anything right out of the box and accept it.
And that's the part that always bums me out when I see... that's why I get so bummed out whenever I see a sound effect in a comic just sort of laid on. You know, it's like, well, here it is in Futura. I made it red. I put an outline around it. And, oh, maybe I'll run a curve on it a little bit. And it's like, wow, you could do better than that. You can like integrate this thing. You could have this thing visually fit into the illustration. And that's gonna be part of the class too, is like how to actually integrate it in Photoshop using masks. You know, whether you're playing with opacity or whether you're using layer masks or whether you know different ways to make, because like you're designing in Illustrator. Well, how is this gonna look in Photoshop? Well, we'll find out when we export it. And then when we get into Photoshop, it's like, how do you?
Watching that, it's a cool process where, and I mean, frankly, watching your class, it made me embarrassed for a lot of the sound effect choices I've made in my comics so far. I look forward to using that now and figuring it out, because it's deep. I mean, it's like you can start putting in detailed design choices on so many aspects that I don't know. I guess for me, I didn't want to tackle it all at once. So.
No, it's a lot to tackle. It's a lot. And, you know, I mean, it's like every comics page presents you with literally 1,000 or more choices, right? So it's like you got to pick some battles. You just got to pick a few with each page, you know? Not every page I do is going to invent a new form of comic storytelling. It's not going to defy traditional reading direction. It's not going to provide you with a unique moment choice that you never expected. You know, you pick those battles as the opportunities come. But, you know... as you get deeper and deeper into it, you discover that, yeah, every step of this thing can be touched by the artist. And when you've done that, you have a truly idiosyncratic piece of fiction there. I mean, that's... the story's got to be good. The character's got to be compelling. Design's got to be good and everything. But, you know, that's one more point in your favor if you've touched everything for it to feel like this is a unique experience that I can't get anyplace else. If you just throw on Times New Roman as your text and just use standard ellipses and, your sound effects are all just, you know, align left, red, impact, you're missing out on some genuine opportunities for expression on there. That's all that I get excited about. Yeah. There you go, with the old standard ellipse, which, you know, in the old days was like the hallmark of an amateur comic. A lot of people these days know better than to do that now, but or unless it's for effect, you know, if it's like something you're specifically going for.
I used to use the rounded rectangle.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, that's a good one.
And again, I mean, it's not like it's invalid or whatever. It just, I realized that it's not the strongest compliment for my art.
Yeah.
Because I've seen the different things fit in different contexts just fine. I mean, you have a robot character, and all of a sudden, certain fonts make a lot more sense. And
sure.
Treatments of word balloons and all that. It's just, but man, am I embarrassed about my sound design. That I can't wait to go back and work on it. Oh, boy.
What's funny is that I'm actually less... This is a personal choice, but given that like I love thinking about sound design, when it comes to dialogue, sound balloons, I am so much less likely to change the font in there than I am anyplace else. Like even when I'm doing a robot character, I try to render their voice through the shape of the balloon rather than through the font that I choose. I think of the font as being sort of like, this is indicating to you that I, the author, am acting through these characters. All these characters are as played by me. And so I use my own personal font for their voices. But okay, but this is my voice run through a synthesizer, so it's going to have a square balloon with a zigzaggy tail, you know, for a robot. But I see that happening in modern comics every once in a while, like Marvel DC kind of stuff, where they'll actually, like, oh, he's a robot, we'll use a computer voice or computer-ish font for the word balloon. That works too. It's just that for me personally, I hesitate to go there. But I do think really hard about, like, okay, what kind of sound is this? Is it a meaty sound? Is it like the sound of like a fist connecting with a slab of beef? Well, that's going to have some hard edge, but it's going to be mostly a round-ish sound. Whereas, oh, this is a metal girder falling onto concrete. That's going to have a really hard, tinny sound. It's going to have hard edges. It's going to be like a lot of corners on the font that I choose. So anyway... a lot of stuff to think about when we think about this stuff, and there'll be future episodes where we go into this even more detail, I'm sure. But
absolutely.
I feel like we got some really good tips, really good things that people could try out today.
Yeah, totally. And I think we can totally save the rest for other times. But I'm gonna, you know, if you wanted to squeeze one more thing in, that's cool. I mean,
who, me or you?
You. I'm good. I covered it. That's it. I'm out of tricks.
Yeah.
Teaching over. Forever.
Yeah. Let's see what I got. Let me try sharing my screen again. Okay. So let's see what else I could do. Well, I can just share a quick, like, this is more of a theoretical thing that I like to think about, is when I start with, let's say... make a sound effect. I'm going to do a meaty sound effect. So, THDSH. Right? The dish. And I'm just going to use my own dialogue font for this. I used this font based on my handwriting quite a bit in the past. So, after I've created outlines, I'm going to ungroup by Command-Shift-G, or it's in the menu under Object. Oh, I didn't even ask it. Can you see this, Rob?
Oh, yeah. Totally. Okay. Looking great. Okay.
So then I'm going to like move these around, and I'm going to think about the rhythm of the sound. And so I'm going to sound it out. I spend a lot of time on my desk sounding out the sounds, like thrish, thrish, thrish. Okay, wait a minute. There's a lot of emphasis on that D. The TH comes in kind of quick. So I'm going to, and also thrish, I'm going to think about, ooh, I'm hitting my microphone. Think about it like a waveform, right? Think about like, okay, it's going to swell at the dish part. And also that th is going to come in kind of smaller, but also like, when I think of a waveform, I think it comes down lower. So I'm going to take this TH, might match them in size a little bit better, and then I'm going to reduce them in size just a little bit, and I'm going to emphasize this D. Now this is where sometimes I'll do a shortcut with the free transform tool. Free transform tool is just like the arrow tool in the sense that just by hovering over a bounding box anchor point, you can just stretch. And it will, right? It'll modify the letter. Free transform tool does another neat thing. If you hover over an anchor point or a corner, bounding box corner, and click and hold, and then hold down the command key, now I can also stretch it like this. It really distorted it. So did you see that?
Yeah.
Zoom in. So I'm going to click and hold, hit the command key, and I'm going to distort it just a little bit, and then I'm going to use just the regular stretch, and then I'm going to angle it a little bit. Now I'm going to think about this a lot when I'm doing my sound design, is like, what kind of angle should we have on this? like more angular, more skewed feels one way, less skewed feels another way. And then the S is also a big sound. So again, I'm going to use that free transform tool. Click on the corner, hold down the command key, stretch it out a little bit. So now it's starting to look like, oh, this isn't his dialogue font. This is something different, even though it was based on my dialogue font. And then grab that H. And this time, this one, I'm not going to do that. Well, no, I'm going to go ahead and use the free transform tool on this one. So I'm going to grab that top corner, click and drag. And now, I also think about spacing too. Like, okay, so like I'm going to want more space between the TH and then the DSH, but the dish is all a connected sound. It has like a, what am I trying to say, like a hiss to it. All the noise is connected in one big noisy lump. So I'm going to go ahead and make sure that they're all overlapping. I'm also going to think about the flow of the letter forms, right? So like I'm going down the D to the S, back up the S, across the H. Because it's also visual design as well as sound design. And then I'm going to grab that exclamation point, and I'm going to angle it a little bit more because I don't want it, if I leave it like it is now, it's going to blend into that H. But if I angle it a little bit, then also use the free transform tool on it. Now, it's connected to the shape without, you know, getting lost in the shape, right? So that would be a quick way that I would design a thedish sound effect, and then I would use a bunch of different layer effects where I'd go to object path, offset path, and let's go 5 pixels out, drag it down a couple layers below, and I would change the color. Oh, and I want to group this afterwards. I forgot to group these letters when I was done modifying them, because it's a lot easier for me to do color modifications once they're grouped. So now I just click on this layer. And if this were a black and white comic, that would probably be the most I would do with it. Oh, and also I have a straight point on there. Get rid of that straight point. There we go. So, but given that if this was a color comic, then I would go in and I would drop in a color gradient of some sort, make it a radial. And wherever the most high frequency part of the sound happens, that's where I'm going to have my brighter color. So it's in the sh part of the thdish. That's a deep bassy sound. The sh is a high tinny sound. So I'm going to start my gradient at the middle of that S and fade out from there. And this is, I don't know if this is based on any kind of real widely accepted color theory, but it's something that the language I've developed for myself is that brighter colors equal more higher frequency, darker colors equal lower frequency. And that sounds like it makes sense to me at any rate. So I'm going to go ahead and drop a blue in here instead and see if that registers. Or maybe like a kind of a purplish, going with our complementary color ideas. A little bit darker on that purple. Right? Maybe even a little brighter on the yellow. So, and then I would go ahead and I would grab this shape, the black behind the fetish, and I would, accidentally selected everything on the layer. There we go. I'm going to select that, object path, offset path, do slightly smaller, 3 pixels out, and then drag that to a layer below. And now I'm going to grab the one layer above, and I'm going to go ahead and drop in the same gradient, but I'm going to select darker colors this time. So go to color picker here, get like a bit of an orangish yellow, and for the purple, go a little bit more blue, a little darker, and then I'm going to switch it to starting the gradient at a different point, like maybe like this. You can play around with it. That second purple needs to be a lot darker. Which can give your illustration or your sound design a little bit more extra pop, a little bit more pizzazz, right? I'm not crazy about these colors that I've chosen, but you get what I'm driving at here. Like there's like different conflicting gradients going on. Like another way to do it would be like switching these to radial gradients. So I'm gonna grab my gradient tool, select, come on, for crying out loud. There we go, color, change this to a linear gradient. And this is where this is both designing sound while also designing visuals at the exact same time. So I'm gonna copy the exact same gradient to the shape behind it. Whoops. But now I'm just going to reverse the direction of the gradient, right? And that can also do something different and unique.
Oh, sweet.
So you can create some pretty complex looking sound effect designs just by messing around with a couple different gradient combinations and using the expand outline feature. I realize now that I also, when I copied that style, I copied a stroke onto it. I don't want a stroke on that one behind it. And then even afterwards, if you decide like, oh, the rhythm of the letter forms here isn't quite right, I need to move some things around, well, just ungroup everything. So I'm going to go and select on every layer, ungroup, select layer behind. That's already ungrouped. Now I can just drag and select and move these elements around. And then I want to go back and modify those gradients again to make sure the gradient's all one smooth thing. So just select all these letters and the second outline and match it into one gradient. And it's like, yeah, a lot of editability and also, you know, a lot of clean, crisp look to it.
Well, and it's very personalized too.
Yeah. I mean, nobody else can make this sound effect because this is my font, right?
Well, yeah, it's your font and it's also your logic. Your whole communication pattern that you've worked out for that.
That's true.
You know, that need.
So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this and I'm going to drag this down to a layer below and I'm just going to offset it a little bit. That creates an extra dimension to the sound effect.
Jeez. Very nice.
Looks so easy. No, but you know, it's just like a little bit of logical thinking and then just playing around with some of these tools. Like that free transform tool is a great shortcut for making your sound effects look a little bit more dynamic and hand-drawn. You could do this with any text, right? So I can just take the letter D and I'll use just like a system font, like, again, Impact. And on its own, the Impact D is not very interesting or dynamic. It's nice and bold and everything, but I'm going to turn it to outlines, and then I grab that free transform tool and click and hold down the command key, and you can do some pretty interesting stuff. And you can do this by letter, but you can also do it by shape. So, like, let's say, or I mean, like, by the whole sound effect. So let's say, like, after I'm done with this, the dish, I'm like, you know what? It would look that much better if I just amped up the dynamism just a little bit more. I'll grab that free transform tool. Now that I got a bounding box around the whole sound effect that I designed, click and hold on that bounding box corner, hold down the command key, and I can modify the entire thing that way too, giving like an extra dimension of oomph.
Jeez.
You get some really interesting effects too when you do stuff on a curve, like if you do like a curved sound effect or a curved logo and you play with that free transform tool. And again, because it's vector, it's like nothing gets distorted by this, right? The lines are all super crisp and everything.
Mm-hmm.
So, yep. That'd be my last tip of the day.
Well, thank you, because I need that one. From a selfish standpoint, yeah, that's cool.
That's half the fun of this thing, is like how much we're learning for our own purposes.
Oh yeah, I mean, there's a lot of like 30 classes in 30 days. I mean, I was absorbing a lot. I mean, from every single class. I mean, it's just really cool to be immersed in that, and then think about how you could apply it to, you know, your own work, right? I mean, obviously that's like you, I don't know, getting inspired to play an instrument because you see a band that you like or whatever. You know, there's not much difference between that and then seeing a good technique that you like that you want to apply to your own work.
Yep. Yeah. And so, yeah, you were sharing earlier, and I won't say what it was, but Oh, it sounds like we got a lot of delay going on.
No, I just started talking over you.
Okay.
It was like we would have a round, right? Where you're just
row your boat.
Anyway.
Well, if anybody deserves to be talked over, it's me. After all the times I've done it to you, so.
No,
but you were sharing earlier before we started recording, and I won't say what you were sharing, but it was an outline for one of your future classes, and I was like, God, I can't wait to take this class. So, yeah, it's there's a lot of really cool resource and information sharing going on with this learning network thing. So, anything else that we wanted to throw out? Any closing thoughts to create a sense of closure, or do we want to just like walk out of the room?
We could totally just ditch this and walk out, but I don't know if it's like putting a total button on or whatnot, but I mean, theoretically, we're sharing a bunch of interesting tricks in Illustrator because, I mean, it's a worthwhile tool. It's just, it gets kind of ignored because, when you're dealing with pixels, there's a certain more obviousness to it because it's not the same as using like something with pigment or ink or whatever on a surface, but it's a lot like it. I mean, you've got your whatever kind of behavior that's going to throw pixels at something, which is a lot like whatever pen or brush you're using on a piece of paper.
And the analog is a lot more intuitive.
There you go.
Yeah. Whereas it's a little bit more opaque in Illustrator, but
get extra deep with your techniques and whatnot in Illustrator, though, and yet you're not trapped. Right. Where pixel-wise, I mean, you can be quite the pixel ninja, but at the same time, you're still going to have to make up for data you're squishing or losing or whatever.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, then there's downsides to using Illustrator and Photoshop together as well, is that in my work, I wind up having to have a final art layer. And then an AI layer, the AI not meaning artificial intelligence, but meaning Adobe Illustrator file. So there's a file for my lettering and then the file for the final Photoshop file. So there's a lot of file management going on my end, to where I'll have a folder for my pencils, a folder for my inks, a folder for my colors, a folder for the Illustrator files, and then a final folder of the compressed TIFFs based on everything that I've done. So that means when I got to go back, and let's say I notice that, okay, I sent my files to Kablam or whoever, and I get my proof copy, and oh, page 15 has a problem with the lettering. Now I have to open up the Illustrator file, modify that, recopy it into the Photoshop file, reflatten it as a TIFF, re-output it as a JPEG to put on my website, as well as update my printer files. So it does become a little bit cumbersome in that respect, but it's nothing that... I'm a pretty disorganized guy for the most part, and I can handle it, so... But there is a trade-off.
Yeah. Adding another step to your process is, you always have to decide if it's worth it for you. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, Illustrator has some huge, huge strengths that I haven't been able to walk away from, even though some of the quirks. Disparage Illustrator, but look at the difference between the line work I was doing when I was playing around. Well. These rocks, I mean, these are natural ink lines, something that got scanned and then actually vectorized and brought into Illustrator. And then these lines I was just doing really quick with, Crunchy lifting up this rock, they have less character, right? So you can see, like, look at what happens when I'm doing a line. Illustrator corrects my shapes. Like, there's this transition, like less of the squiggle and detail are present. Anyway, some people find a way to make that work for them. I know some artists that draw completely in Illustrator.
Mm-hmm.
But yep. those little quirks for me regulated it to a specific step in my process.
Yeah. So cool. I think this was there was a lot of useful stuff in this one, so I feel good about it. I feel like I can put it down. And
all right, well, cool. I do too. We got to get out of the 2-hour habit anyway. But
well, some people are gonna say no, but some people are gonna say thank God. Either way, we should point people at leanintoart.com, where you can find out about FATAM, a hands-on approach to designing sound elements in Adobe Illustrator, and that is January 7th, 11th, 14th. Registration is open now. You can sign up. We have three different tiers. You can participate via live classes if you want to take the class live and actually interact with me while we do it, or you can take it in a time-shifted manner at a slight discount, and you'll just get the video files after the fact and enjoy them at your convenience. But there is a lab, and so the silver and gold tiers both get access to the lab, where we can do some, like, actually playing around with the work in progress. And then there's the bronze level. Bronze level, you just get the two videos of the class files, and they're going to be two-hour sessions, if I'm not mistaken. So it's like 4 hours of content. A lot of stuff.
Oh, yeah, and it's deep. I mean, obviously, this is a topic that Jerzy's very passionate about, has a lot of awesome sound design kung fu to share. And it sounds like you're going to hit some of the logo aspect stuff too, right? So.
Oh, yeah, yeah. All this applies to logo design as well. You can use all of these techniques that I use for sound effects to create some really interesting-looking logos. So.
All right.
I'm not going to say that my logo kung fu is as good as my sound design kung fu, because I don't think about logos nearly as much as sound design. That's an area where I want to brush up on my skills. But at least the techniques can be used to do just about any logo that you've seen on a product or a poster or whatever. So, but yeah, thanks, Rob, for this good episode. This was fun.
Yeah, cool. This was fun. Thank you, Jerzy. It was your idea. I'm glad we did it. We should, yeah. Looking forward to more of these visual ones where we just kind of play around with.
And that's the other thing that we're probably going to do. I don't know. Probably starting beginning of the year, of the new year, 2012, the last year of human existence, as I understand it. That's what the news keeps telling me. We're going to open up these visual episodes to be for people to participate in them. But it's going to be only open, I believe, to Lean Into Art members. Like, if you sign up for a class, you'll also get access to the forum. And in the forum is when we're going to announce when the live shows are going to be happening and you can participate.
Exactly.
It's a part of, like, the ongoing learning network stuff that we want to do with this thing. So there'll be, like, these visual ones will be live. Details to come. But if you sign up for a class, you'll get an early look at that because... you know, we'll be posting about it in the Lean Into Art forums. So,
yes, yeah. Indeed. Lots of fun. Always working on experimenting and adding to what we're doing here. So,
yeah. Only had so much, Rob.
I suppose. Maybe we did hit our limit. Maybe we've done too much already.
No.
And like I'm ever going to say that seriously?
No, because I saw your outline for your upcoming class, and it was like, I expected it to be like a page of outline. It was like 3 pages of outlines, and I was like, well, there goes Rob again. Is it difficult? Is it probably a bad idea? I'll take it on. So it's never enough for you to just do one little thing. You got to do like 10 awesome things in a row before you feel satisfied.
We'll see. I don't know. I yeah, I don't know. It's tough. I don't know. It's
people know I'm not a liar, so they'll agree with me when the thing gets posted. But okay,
fair enough. I have no comment I can make through my awkwardness and discomfort. So
oh, that's the way it is with all of us cartoonists and artists and visual storytellers. We all hate being told that we're any good at what we do. Well, I'll just get out of here and let Rob be embarrassed. So until next time, everybody, thanks for listening and downloading. If you want to help out the show, if you think the stuff is good for people, if you think people should like it, then go to iTunes and give us a star review. You don't even have to write a review. Just say, hey, X amount of stars for this show. I like it. Even if, you know, if you don't like it, you could always put less stars, but if you don't got something nice to say, don't say nothing at all. That's what they say on Bambi. So you can just say the nice things. How about that?
Yeah. Power us via encouragement.
Yeah, not through punishment. So yeah, until next time, everybody, I've been Jerzy Drozd of comicsaregreat.com and Jerzy on Twitter,
and I have been Rob Stenzinger of interactive-storyteller.com and Rob Stenzinger on Twitter.
Okay, bye.